Are you having a good time? A good day? I'm excited.
Being back in Melbourne.
It's awesome. I wish that I'd see, I didn't really see much Melbourne, you know. The first time I was here, I stayed like 3 extra days. And I was like, 3 lost jelly. At the end of the 3 days, I was like, tourists. I don't have that much time this time, but I love it here. I really love Melbourne. It's so like artsy and cool.
Yeah, what's with that? What's with not liking Perth?
Can I speak on Perth?
We can talk about Perth.
I'd like to say a few words about Perth. You know, this is fact. I've never been to Perth. And I'm sure if I go, which I will someday, I expect to get the key to the city because I'm going to love that city. I can show those people how much I love them. And I've got to somehow figure out how to turn this back on Richard. Because he made it up. And this joke, now 4 years strong. It's amazing how people really still think that I hate Perth. Because Richard said, oh, you know, Rob hates Perth. And then no matter how much I say, I know. I've never been there. And people go, yeah.
It's too high.
No matter how much I say that, people are like, well, it is a really lovely city. Yeah, no, I'm sure it is. But anyway, don't hate Perth. Don't hate it. Never did. But it's a funny bit, isn't it? It's weird. It's funny. Like, people who don't know that joke, like, it's our story. Your family just moved in across the street from me. And they're like, yeah, we lived in Perth. And they don't know this joke at all. And I'm like, I've never been. I'm sure I would love it. But to be what you hear. They're like, what are you talking about? So, someday.
I'm so excited to send that message back.
Yeah, exactly.
You're like, oh, I'm here.
Right, no, because I have this picture where like my face is up to the square and people don't think so.
Yeah. We got one or two from today.
Oh, I hope so, yeah. I hear they love this place. I hope they love
When you guys go back home, you just spread the news.
There's nothing I can do about this joke. There's nothing, it's like it's out of control. I can't stop it. I can't rein it in. I guess I'm going to have to go to Perth. That's the only way to stop it.
It's really hard. It's hard.
Like how long the flight?
Well, if you do
3.5.
4 hours? On top of the 16, you know.
Right. This country is huge. 4 hours.
Yep.
Gosh. I thought it was like, I'm skipping a jump up the first. Yeah. It's in New York and LA.
Yeah.
Yes. 5 hours, yeah. Great, great. Great, great. Wow. Yeah, someday I'll go. So that's west, on the west side, right?
Yes, yeah.
I don't want to go to the east side too. I want to go to the Gold Coast and all that. Yeah, I've only been in Sydney and Melbourne.
What about Tasmania?
Tasmania would be fun. Where's that?
Really?
Where in the country?
South.
It's
an island below us.
Oh, it's not even, it's not attached. You guys don't understand this. I'm a pretty smart person. Like, I got really good grades. But I'm like one of those kind of like dumb smart people. So I ask a lot of stupid questions. For instance, Jason Manns likes to point out a couple nights ago, I said, do you call this summer or winter? And I thought, and then we did the whole thing and he laughed and I was like, oh my God, I can't believe I said that, I'm so dumb. And then just now today, I forgot what the answer was. He's like, what do you think this is right now? I go, winter. I said, are you messing with me? He's like, no, this is their summer. I knew that the seasons were different. I just didn't know if he called it summer or winter. Gosh, I'm sorry.
You're just not that sick.
Yeah, I guess. I just can't think of what. Maybe I'm not the letter over here.
All right, well,
these have obviously pressing questions for you.
Great.
So what we've done for the others is we've got everyone to line up because it makes it nice and easy. So ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question for Rob, just kind of quickly jump into the line here. All right, we're going to start with Connor. Stand around, buddy. Oh, that?
Thanks. Hey, buddy. Are we good?
Good.
What's up? What do you want to know?
In season 5 finale, where do you think Chuck went when he disappeared?
That's a good question. That's a really good question. Well, my theory is that people may, I mean, you can think whatever you want to think about where Chuck went. But my theory is that was Eric Kripke's last show, right? He created the show. He's the creator of the show. So I think that was his acknowledgement that my character was supposed to be kind of like him, as the sort of almighty creator of the show. And so he said, be with him. The writers go. Which I think is like heaven, and then that would make me kind of like God.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Good, I've never done it this way. This is really fun.
I have a question that my family wants me to ask, and one that I've asked the other guests.
Okay.
First one. Do you know if Charlie is coming back? I haven't watched season 11 at all.
I don't know. I really have no idea. It's a good. You'd think that maybe I would know these things. I know that people love Charlie, and we're really sorry to see her go. That was like heartbreaking. I would love it. I just love it if Felicia comes back to the conventions. Like, hey, out there, I have a really good crush on her.
Is, what is your favorite minor character?
Favorite minor character? Would that be like guest star?
Any of them.
Any of them. My favorite minor character. Did you guys see the episode that Richard directed that was just on?
Yeah.
I remember like the guy who played Sam's imaginary friend. But if I'm taking it back, and I have to pick my favorite minor character. I don't tell my attendants, but I suppose the trickster would be one of my favorite.
Okay.
Don't tell him, he doesn't even know that.
Mine's Sheriff Donald.
Does
anyone know that?
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you.
So this is a question that's bugged me for like 6 years. So like think back. So Sam and Dean find those books that Chuck had been writing.
Yeah.
And they read through them and like he's seen everything word for word. I mean, he's seen Dean full frontal, naked, like he's seen everything. So why, when they rocked up in his front door, did he not recognize them?
It's like he didn't have the awareness that what he was seeing was actually a real thing. He thought it was fiction, right? So I guess he just thought it was people messing with him. You make a great point.
Yeah. It's annoyed me for a very long time.
Yeah. I liked it. Like, the way that I was playing it was more like, you know, it's like, yeah, you can't imagine that what those, these things that I've been, the visions I've been seeing and the things I've been writing are actually real.
Yeah.
And so it was his sort of like, you know, he's also been drinking a lot.
That explains it.
So he thought maybe, you know, let's go with that. Let's go with, he's kind of an alcoholic.
Yeah. So he's like blurry, so he didn't recognize
him. He hadn't seen the light of day in a long time, and he'd been drinking quite a bit, so he just didn't know. I just couldn't possibly imagine that it was real.
Okay, thank you.
I'm still stuck on full frontal view. I never thought about that. Yes, ma'am. Hello.
My question is that if Chuck could come back in season 11, what would his reaction be?
Well, I mean, I think that he's, you know, there's a lot going on. I think he's like, things are out of control.
Yes.
And now here's the darkness. And, you know, he's just got a lot of stuff he's got to straighten out. So, I mean, I think he would think, all right, we've got some work to do. We got a lot of work to do. Let's get, we got not a lot of time. We got a lot of work to do. That would be his reaction. What have you guys been doing? And where have I been vacationing? Why haven't I been here? I think it feels like the time is right for him to sort of come back and work it out.
Yeah.
He's got a fight to fight. You know what I mean? Yeah. But I think his first reaction certainly, like, poof, comes back, would be like, oh, Jesus. Not what he has done. Something like that. Yeah. That's usually my reaction to most things. That would be my reaction when I go back upstairs and do this. Oh, Jesus. I'll leave you alone for 5 minutes.
This is what you've done.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I think we can all agree that the Supernatural parody by The Hollywood Show is amazing.
Yeah, first of all, I totally agree. It's amazing. And I can't watch it enough. Like, every time I watch it, I don't really feel that way about things that I'm hearing. But, like, I'm fascinated by the work that went into it, how well of a job they did, how they tapped into the fandom so well, so respectfully, and that everybody knows it. Like, in karaoke, you know, if that song comes on, if the Taylor Swift version comes on, everybody's singing their words. And that's amazing to me. I thought about this trip that when I get home, I want to text those guys and say, like, do you know? How in Australia it's huge. You know what I mean? Like, it's amazing to me. Working on it, it was great. I mean, at first, they were at one of the conventions, and that's when we did everyone dancing at the end. And it was like, no one knew really what it was. They put on the Taylor Swift version of that song, and we all just like danced and had fun. And we didn't quite know, we knew it was going to be kind of a parody video, but we didn't know what. Then later, like a couple weeks later, I was like, hey, do you want to be in it? And I was like, sure, what, doing what? And he was like, well, you'd be playing like Tim Robinson. And I was like, well, I'd love to be in it, but like, are you sure? I'm like a mini-me Tim Robinson. And then he was like, exactly. That's kind of the point, because they're little, everyone's little. And I was like, okay, sure. I mean, those guys seem great. So they flew me to Vegas where they live. And again, I didn't quite get the Tim Robinson thing. I was like, I can do a Tim Robinson eyebrow. But they put the beard on me and the wig and showed the mirror in front of what it looked like. And it was crazy. Like, I never thought before, I looked exactly like him. Out. I was like, oh my god.
You missed actually a video of your reaction to that in the behind the scenes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And it's crazy because I can't smile with the beard on, or else it'll come off. So I was like, oh my god. You're amazing. But you probably can't tell really that inside I was like freaking out. Unbelievable. But yeah, and I made the eyebrow and I couldn't stop, and it was super, super fun. It was really cool. My favorite part to shoot was the wind blowing in my head.
Sorry, I'm a huge fan of your band. That's right.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you think you're bringing them down here anytime soon.
They say hello. They are dying to come down. It's always hard when I'm like, so listen, just, I got invited, but they want to bring you, you know, so they want to come, they want to be here. So, yeah, so it's just talking to Carissa, like, we're putting it together. We're trying to do that. In reality, the next year or two, but we are going to make it happen. I really want you guys to sort of just see the band and also sort of experience what we've been able to do in the States, which is, you know, we do these shows, we do the creation conventions, if you haven't been to one. On Saturday night, we do this big show, and people, actors come on stage, we do some cover songs with them, and if every city we go to winds up being this spiritual experience, and I'm not exaggerating, it really is an amazing experience, and I want to experience that with you. So.
Chuck realized he was a prophet, he was very daunted by it. I'm just wondering, if for argument's sake it does turn out that he's been God and he's just been not wanting to say, how would you kind of want it to be revealed, and would you be kind of worried about what Dean would think? Because this whole time you've sort of seen him blaming, or would you kind of use the excuse, it's like, well, to defeat the good fight, we have the good fight, I have to deal with the things which contradicts me being good, like, the little loophole is like, don't hit me.
Yeah, I mean, it's complicated, and I think that's one of the reasons that it's taken a while to sort of be intelligent about bringing my character back. Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting to see if that happens, you know, what that looks like. So I'm just giving Rob's opinion, but you know, I think the last couple of times we saw Chuck at the very end of season 5, mm-hmm. and in the 200th episode,
yeah.
he had this sort of different thing about him going on. It was just mm-hmm. a different Chuck, really. Yeah. And so I don't think it's going to be the same Chuck. That was like, holy cow, you know. I can't be, and I'm God too, you know. That's like a bad Chuck imitation. So I think it's going to be sort of deeper than that.
Yeah, because he's been through a lot. He's passed these years or whatever time as well, so he could have gone through a lot. And then he's like, great, I finally get up the courage to tell you, and he got loose about it.
Yeah, so it'll be complicated when it happens. But I think, the belief probably would be that obviously God is not this one embodiment of this person, just like Lucifer. He just went inside this body.
Yeah.
And I think the same would be true for Chuck and God. He's going to put him in this recognizable body that the boys will know. And,
yeah.
You know, and so I think that's sort of the realm we would be working with.
So, like, Chuck finds out that he's the person, and then he's like, oh, well, darn it, now I'm actually my home, and this can only crap things.
Yeah. You should write for the show.
Yeah.
It's fine. Yeah, I don't know any more than you, but. It would be cool if it happens, and then we would have a lot of answers for me.
Hi.
Hi.
A while ago, you and Rishi were doing a Kings of Con talking about your stream.
Yes.
You had a bag of pretzels from Boy Tito.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you ever got a sponsorship for that, because you talk about it a lot. Right?
Yeah.
I still remember, that was like 6 months ago.
Yeah. I heard in my mind too. So, I don't know if you know about Richard. Richard and I did this. We're going to do this show called Kings of Con. And it's really just a vehicle for me and Rich to be able to do what we do when we're on stage together. Really, it's us, just our quirky friendship and how crazy we are. But it's the backdrop of the conventions, it's the setting. We went on Indiegogo and a lot of people supported the show, which was amazing. And so during that time or somewhere around then, we did a live stream chat, and we decided to have lunch. It was like having lunch with Rob and Rich. So I made us peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and I quickly went to my closet and I had a bag of Nutinos, which I happen to like. I'm not even allergic to gluten, but I like the taste of gluten and fruit pretzels. It was right there, and then people started commenting about it looks like you've got an Afro Latino. And then we were joking, and then people did put pictures up. And then literally like a day later, Latino tweeted us and was like, thanks for the press or whatever, thanks for the shout out. Can we have an address, we'll send you a box of Latinos. So, like 2 weeks later, we get this gigantic box of everything Latino, which I didn't even know they made. Latino pancake mix. Latino caramel. It was awesome. Latino caramel pretzels, chocolate pretzels, all the pretzels you can think of. Strawberry pretzels. It was a strawberry. With chocolate, crackers. And the king of our office, the king of our shared office, the king of the office, and we were both like, wow! And the next thing we know, he was like, where did the box and the tails go? And I was like, well, I took him home. Because there was my bag of pretzels. It's fun about that, but I got to keep them. You know, just to give you a quick update too is where the show is moving right along. We've written all the episodes, and I really can't wait to show it to you. I think you're really gonna like it. We're gonna probably start shooting it in January. We're just waiting to close a contract on a place that will be its home. So very soon we'll make an announcement and say, hey, Kings of Con will be able to be seen here, and we'll start shooting it. And it has a lot of people you know in it, and it'll be really great. So.
You kind of answered my question now, but my question was, so what was the next step with Kings?
Yeah, so that's yeah. That's reading Chuck. That's basically it. Richie gets mad because I say too much. He's like, we don't know, just wait, you know. So I have to wait till the contract is finished and then I can tell you where it's going to be. And after that, we'll start shooting it. But yeah, the episodes are all written and they're really funny. And I just can't wait. And I was saying yesterday in Sydney that, you know, like I think about you guys as the audience, you know what I mean? Like I know that you all get me and Richard and what it is sort of about our quirky craziness that can be funny. you know, so I really do think I'm writing it with you in mind as an audience, so can't wait.
Thank you.
So like you said before, when you came back in the 200th episode, you weren't Chuck exactly. Right. But if Prophet Chuck came back and saw Supernatural the musical, how do you think he would have felt?
Freaked out. Freaks the F out. I mean, it's convention episode Chuck, you know, where it's like the shakes and the water bottle, and he's not comfortable with that kind of attention. He would have been like that reaction to the convention, where he just was like nervous.
And proud?
Well, yeah, he's proud, you know Chuck. He's proud, but he's also just like sort of, you know, a writer who's hard on himself and he can't imagine anyone would read his books. The life of him, you know. So yeah, he's always going through a struggle. You know, writing is hard, and I never asked for this, you know, that whole thing. So it's actually nice to make the transformation into sort of the godly Chuck, which is like, it's all good, man. But no, I think old Chuck definitely would have been freaked out. But he would have liked it. Yeah. Yeah, he would like it. He liked it. He doesn't like attention on him at all. You know, like there was one scene, one episode. I think it was the first episode I did where like they start fighting. Misha starts, or Castiel starts fighting with the boys or something. And I just in the back, I just kind of get up and walk away. Conflict. And it's my house. I think I'm not allowed to go upstairs. That's weird. He's a weird dude. I like this shirt.
Thank you.
course, this thing is really cute. I didn't imagine, I didn't think this when I was coming down here that we were going to be all, that we really were embracing the Christmas, and I really love it.
I was hoping Jim might have been here to see my shirt, but that's okay. I'll show it up.
Well, I appreciate it.
Following up from the end of season 5, when the show was originally supposed to end, and you were the narrator giving us the ending, how did you feel? Did you feel really honored to be doing that, or did you feel that it was unnecessary?
The first one. I was like blown away, honored to do that, and to be able to say those words, which I feel like all the seasons, that's one of the best written episodes. Just the words themselves are just beautiful, and I just say I got choked up, like in the recording booth when I was doing it. So I was just, anytime they asked me to do that, when they had me narrate the special before the 200th episode, I was so honored. Like, I get emotional about it, I feel emotional about it, and I felt the same way about that episode. So I was so honored then to come back and do that special before the 200th episode to be able to do that again.
Choked me up too.
And I feel like there are other some references they make sort of to that. The
Batman column.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And the thing stuck in the thing and the thing. I tell you what I didn't remember. And the boys with the thing stuck in the thing. They always knew do everything be cool. The brothers and stuff. Yeah, I'm a smart person. That was a really cool episode to be a part of. I thought that was really neat. And it was really Eric Ricky's sort of love letter to the show. Yeah, that's cool.
Opinion on like the inception that is your character, like how your character is the author of a book that has a fandom, that is a shout out to the show that has a fandom, and like how does like Inception the TV show, how does that tie into how you view and play Chuck?
I mean, it's a trip, it's a real trip, and from the beginning there was that element to the character, sort of a nod of it's the show looking back at itself as a show. I always thought that was genius. That's one of the things I really loved about playing that character, and doing all the stuff he did and doing the convention episodes and everything and taking it to that level. I just loved that. I thought it was a really cool, genius way to do it. The show has done that with like a handful of episodes, right? The French Mistake and a couple of Richards episodes, the change of channels, and I love that. I love it when it kind of turns back and stuff. And I can almost have a dialogue with the fans. It's almost like there were times where I felt like there were even things like in my first episode, I referenced episodes that fans had complained about in the first few seasons. So like, bugs. And I didn't know. Like I hadn't watched Supernatural season 4 when I started. So I had to go back and like watch those episodes and get stories told to me about like, oh, this is because there's all these private to you guys, like wink to you. It's like, I'm so sorry about bugs. He says that he's talking to you, I thought that was, I think it's kind of genius. And you don't see any other show doing that. And it's also such a, like, I think the success of this show and this whole thing that we have is so unique to our time. Like where, when I started acting, you couldn't have this dialogue with people watching TV. And now we can because of social media. Now we really can have a conversation, I think that's kind of cool. So, and this whole thing, which you can't ever describe to anybody who's not here, and the relationship we have with you, and you have with us, and we all have with each other, and the friendships that I've made with people like Richard, Matt, and all these people that I never worked with before. The friendships I've made with you guys and the relationships you guys made with each other, it's mind-blowing. So I think it all comes back to that. I think I love that I get to be in these episodes that illustrate that.
be here today. And he's like, I have to ask you his question for him because I need to move out, like, because we're not friends anymore if I don't.
Oh, no. Well, by all means, let's answer this question. I don't want to be...
Yeah, so he wants to know, when you first got the character, like, Chuck, did you expect as big of, like, a reaction from the fandom as you've gotten? And, like, was the whole God thing playing from the start, or did that just kind of happen?
That's a good question. Joanna can't answer it. No, it's a great question, actually. Yeah, what was the first half?
Okay, so did you expect the whole
Oh, man, I was hoping. I just didn't, like, I remember, so when I started working, this whole social media was just kind of, like, Twitter was really just kind of getting going. And Misha had recently gotten on, you can imagine, right? And Misha was checking it the night after another episode had aired. I'm working, but an episode aired, and he's online looking to see what people said about it. And I was like, what is this? What are you doing, you know? And then I was like, you know, the conventions had just started, and I knew about those, and I was like, do you think people are going to like Chuck, you know? And he was like, I hope so, man, you know, I hope so. I think it's a great character. And, you know, but I didn't know. I didn't know what the reaction would be. And I was like, please. And then after my first episode, I remember going on Twitter and kind of looking to see what people were saying. And people were like, oh, by the way, I went through at Chuck. And then I went to Twitter, and I was like, oh, my God. So I was hoping. So I was really pleased with it, that people liked Chuck. And so, you know, but Chuck was supposed to be just a one-off character. That was just that episode. So no, I don't, if they had plans to make him God, they didn't tell me. I didn't know that he was God until I was reading the script of that last episode of season 5. I was like, oh, this is so great, so well written. I turned the page and I poofed. And I went, what's that? I'm missing Paige. And then I went out, and I still didn't know, just like you guys, you're like, wait, what? And one of the boom guys was like, so how does it feel you're God? And I was like, is that what this is? Like, put me aside, you know? And then finally Kripke called me, and he's like, yeah, so, blah, blah, this is what I meant it to be, but I want the fans to interpret it however they want to, you know. It was a weird conversation because he was like, you know, how's it feel? I was like, feels pretty high, how's it feel? And he was like, great. So you may not be back for a while. And I was like, oh, okay. I just want you to know what your hopes are because, you know, now that we've introduced you as this special character, you can't just come back and be like, hey, I'm God. What did I miss? So anyway, that was kind of like a awesome and awful conversation at the same time. I just knew he was a prophet. I didn't know until the very last minute that there was the God thing. But you know, it's so great that I can talk about. And it's so great that, like, you know, now it's like we're still going and there's no sign of stopping. So I think we're gonna get questions answered. That's my hope.
So you almost answered this before when you were talking about Pink
Okay.
I was wondering, where did the idea actually come from and what made you decide to actually make it into a show?
Right, so Rich and I, you know, had so many experiences traveling the world together and we make each other laugh a lot. And we'll constantly go, wow, we should write this down. This could be a show. This is funny, you know. And then finally one day we're like, okay, let's start writing this down because this is too good. And, you know, we're gone from our families for, you know, 17 to 20 weeks to weekends a year. And we're like, let's make something out of this. Let's do something creative with it. And so that was sort of the instigating idea came from that. The motivating idea came from that. And then we wrote a pilot, and I wrote a pilot, and it was like, it was what the show would look like, you know? And so our manager said, well, you should just make that. And so we were like, okay, so we made it, and then we edited it, and the idea was that it was just gonna go out to people who run TV shows to see if we could maybe have it on TV as a TV program. and then they were like literally the, right after we got done editing what we shot, like news came out the next day that there's our show was called Conmen. Was the name of our show. This is not a joke. And then the news came out that the show called Conmen had just broken records on Indiegogo. And it's a show with Alan Tudyk and Nathan Fillion, and it's about sort of their experiences in their convention world. So after we debated knocking ourselves off, jumping off the nearest bridge, we decided that, you know what? This is a sign from the universe to keep going. This says, this is a subject people want to hear about, you know? And every time like this, you'll notice like two movies or two TV shows, like Chicago Hope and ER came out the same year. They're both these medical shows. Like, it just means that the universe, like people are thinking the same thing as us. We took it as a sign to keep going. And so we went on Indiegogo and raised awareness about it. And then it became its own, you know, thing. And now it helped us. And now it's not just this one-off pilot we wrote. Now it's going to be a full series. And it's going to be way different than what they're doing. And we changed the name, but I'm not seeing their show, but I know kind of what it is. And I don't think that's it's the same, maybe the same world, but nothing is this. You know, nobody has what we have here. I'm uniquely Rob, and he's uniquely Rich, and our relationship is so weird funny that it's going to be its own thing. And so we really are, you know, it all comes back to like the relationship to these two people, and that, you know, we're the craziest people in the room. And so, anyway, I hope that answered your question.
I was one of the people who
wanted to join. Oh, thank you so much. Aww. We're blown away by all the support. And again, we kind of did it as like, we got to just get to, our thought was like, we don't want it to be like, after the fact, like, we also have a show. You know, we wanted to sort of get out the right away to go, this is something we've been working on at the same time, you know. And so that's what we sort of did that Indiegogo. We wanted to create awareness. We were blown. I don't know what we expected. We didn't expect the support that we got. It was overwhelming and it was surprising. But at the same time, this fan has proven again and again that it's like, it's so supportive and loving. And so, anyway, we were blown away by that. I'm just excited. I'm excited that we get to make this and share it with you soon.
So as a character, Chuck evolved quite a bit for this time on the show. And I was just wondering what your favorite aspect of him as a character was.
I think it's like a piece of paper for me. My favorite aspect of Chuck. I like that he's a self-deprecating guy who, like I said, like never really asked for any of this. And I just loved the idea that this is a guy that's a prophet and then ultimately maybe God who had no idea. He's not like the super cocky person who's like, and you're God. Oh no, I'm God. I told you I'm God. You know, that it's just this writer in it because it's just so... You know, it's like, someone said, what would Chuck's song be? And I said, it would be, What If God Were One of Us? Right? I like that he's this normal dude who never imagined this, you know? Because what if, right? You think you're just this writer and you're not, it's so hard, and then it's become this thing, you know? That's how it works, you know? And you can never predict. You can't go, as an artist, you can't go, I'm gonna make this, you know? You can't go, I'm gonna be a star. Like, what? No, you're not. Like, you just can, all you can do is go like, I'm an artist and I'm gonna create and you know, who knows what's gonna happen. So, I just like that. I like that he's just a normal dude. Thanks.
question today. Oh, wait, we did this at home. Can I do it? Or real quick, can I answer?
One
real quick.
What was it like working with Jaren Jensen?
Right. I felt unbelievably short. My inspirations are with other musicians, you know, people like Jason Vance. other musicians really inspire me a lot in music. I listen to music all the time, and it really inspires me. I mean, that was the easiest answer all day. Thanks, everybody.